Hello and welcome to the Adobe Twitch channel. My name is Terry White, worldwide design and photography evangelist for Adobe. It's my pleasure to be here live on this beautiful Friday morning. And this is my normal slot. I'm here on Tuesdays and Fridays from 10 a.m. till noon Eastern. That's 7 to 9 Pacific time. And I'm usually the first one to kick things off in the channel on Tuesdays and Fridays. So welcome. For those of you who are new or watching this as a video on demand or replay, note that the Adobe channel is usually live about 17 to sometimes 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, even on holidays sometimes. So there's always something going on here at twitch.tv/Adobe. You can always watch creatives doing something creative. So with that said, today I'm going to kind of continue where I dropped off or left off on Tuesday. Tuesday I had a special guest, I had Nathaniel Dotson. And Nathaniel was, he's a pro retoucher, so he was showing us some of his retouching techniques and tips and tricks. And then in the last, I think, 30 minutes or so, I started doing some of my own retouching after Nathaniel was done. And I didn't get very far because we ran out of time. So I'm going to continue now, and I actually have some additional images to retouch now that some of the people that I did the shoot for have made their selections. For those of you who are new to photo retouching, we'll do some basics. We'll do some things that you should think about, look for. And of course, retouching of just about, you know, all the things in Photoshop, retouching is probably the most subjective. It's one of those things where you can do a little, you can certainly overdo it, you can do something in between, but it's really at the end of the day up to you and your client. So don't get discouraged. By the way, and this usually only happens from other photographers. don't get discouraged when another photographer tells you how they would have done it or how they would have, you know, done it differently, because that's just the nature of photographers, I guess. So, and also with that said, just like everything in Photoshop, there are all kinds of ways to approach or get to the same result. Some are faster, some are easier, some are, I guess you could even say better, but at the end of the day, it's really about what you're comfortable with, which techniques you're comfortable with. So like, for example, I was watching Nathaniel do his skin retouching, his dodge and burn techniques, his stray hair removal techniques, and while he was achieving his goals, I was looking at it saying, yeah, that's cool. I do it a different way, and that's fine. That's okay that my way is different than his. My way will be different than a lot of people. Nathaniel tends to work with a lot of layers. I tend to work with fewer layers, and nothing wrong with that. It's totally up to you. So when you see someone doing retouching, when you see someone doing anything in Photoshop for that matter, if it's something you don't know how to do, then yeah, take a look at what they're doing and the way they're doing it and see if you can replicate it. And if that works for you, great, you've got a new technique. If you see someone doing something and you say, well, hey, I would do it differently, then do it differently. You don't have to do it their way. You also don't have to tell them you would do it differently. I think that's the thing we get into, is everyone's set in their way of doing things, and they think if anyone else doing it a different way, it must be wrong. So that's also not the case. So now that we got all that out of the way, when it comes to professional retouching, like I said, it could be everything from something very simple to something over the top. And typically we see over the top retouches on celebrities. We see over the top retouches on magazine covers and articles where they are perfect. Like there's not a hair out of place. There's not a wrinkle. There's not a, and I mean wrinkle anywhere, clothes, face, whatever. There's nothing out of place. And I used to attempt to do those kind of retouches on everyday people, and I found that it was too much. It was just over the top. I cringe when I look back at some of my older work. So with that said, my retouches of late have been more moderate, more kind of, you know, just enough. In other words, retouching is usually not about doing one big thing and it's night and day. It's about doing a lot of little things to improve the photo overall. And that goes in not just for portrait retouching. I tend to try and do that with all of my photography. I want it to look like the scene or look like the person as I was taking a photo. But I also don't want it to be so far over the top, especially with people, that you look at it and say, who's that? Like, that doesn't even look like the person anymore because you went too far. So those are kind of the things we're going to talk about and be doing today. For those of you who are new to the channel, it'd be great if you can give the Adobe channel a follow, and certainly give my channel a follow if you're on my channel at Terry L. White. And let's see, all my photos that I'm going to be working on today are going to start in Lightroom because it's just where they are, and then we'll go over to Photoshop to do the actual retouching. But there are some things I do in Lightroom. I always do in Lightroom first. And people that have been watching me for a while say, oh my God, he's going to do that same thing. Yeah, I do that same thing every time because that's my workflow. And if you watched me retouch before, it's not going to be a whole lot different today. So it is what it is. All right, so with that said, let me jump over here. Let me kind of show you what we're going to be working with today. That's Photoshop. Let's pop over to Lightroom. And so here's a gallery, or a collection, I should call it, of some of the images from my last shoot. And when I say some, I say that for a reason. Let me twirl this up, and let me go down here. Here are the 313, non-rejected shots, I should call them. And out of these 313, I've picked a few that I like. Those are the ones that are in green, with the green label. And, hey, Ice Pack Zach, how's it going? And, I've also, sent this gallery to the dancer here, the ballerina, as well as the makeup artist. And the makeup artist has already responded with her choices. And those are the virtual copies that are in yellow. So if I go to my collections here, there's a Maggie Ballerina edits. And in that collection, you'll see the greens. Those are the ones I've retouched already. And then you'll see the gold ones or the yellow ones. And these are the ones that I have not retouched yet. These are the ones that the makeup artist has chosen. And what was interesting, especially when I saw this one, I looked at this one, and for a split second, I thought, did I just accidentally flip this one over? Like, because it looked so close to the one that I had already done, I thought, did I accidentally, somehow flip it over? And no, it's a totally different one, but this is how good this particular dancer is. It looks like a mirror image almost. Now, there are slight differences. One leg's a little higher than the other one in the other shot. And her hand is a little higher on that backdrop, which I'm going to have to adjust for that as well. But it's just funny that was like the first thing I noticed was, wait a minute, I already redid that shot. No, it's just a different one facing the other way. And as luck would have it, the makeup artist didn't pick the one I had already done. She picked that one. Now, I wonder if I took that one and flipped it over and gave it to her, would she notice? But no, we'll go ahead and retouch it. All right. So anyway, all of these in yellow are the ones that we need to retouch today. I don't know how many we'll get through. I do know that I'm going to do a couple in particular to make sure we get through them. So for example, this is definitely one of my favorites. I'm going to move that to be next. And we're going to also do a portrait. So we're going to do our best to get through those three. And if we get through more, we get through more. But those three are definitely the ones I want to concentrate on. All right. So those of you who are watching this as a replay or video on demand, know that this show is live. And therefore, I will take a moment to say something to people in the chat or answer questions in the chat or give shout outs in the chat because it is a live show. So if you're watching the recording, you're saying, who's he talking to? You can be one of those people that I'm talking to as well, just by joining me live here on Tuesdays and Fridays at twitch.tv/Adobe. All right, so with that said, and now that we got the ground rules out of the way, there's one more thing I'm going to talk about, and it's important, and it's a piece of hardware that you should invest in if you're going to do any serious retouching or any serious work in Photoshop to begin with. And that is a graphics tablet. Now, I'm fond of Wacom tablets. I don't work for Wacom. I don't get a commission from Wacom. I don't even get an acknowledgement from Wacom most of the time that I exist, but I do like Wacom tablets and I do recommend them. With that said, I really don't care what brand tablet you ultimately get as long as you get a tablet. When you're working with a mouse, this thing right here, or one like it, even if it's got multiple buttons like my HP one here, and scroll wheels and all that, the problem with a mouse trackball or trackpad is that they all have buttons and knobs and whatever, but when you click, it's either on or off. That's it. There is no in between. It's either you're not using it or you're using it by pressing the button down. The difference between that experience and a stylus or a pen on a tablet is night and day. Because if you're using any modern tablet, it's going to have thousands of levels of pressure. So that means the slightest little touch means I'm doing a little bit in Photoshop. The harder I press down, I'm doing more. And most of the Photoshop brushes and tools can be adapted or switched on, or they're already on by default, to adjust things like the flow, how much of it you're doing by the amount of pressure. Or in a lot of cases, I like to do it with the brush size. The harder I press, the bigger the brush is. The less I press, the smaller the brush is. Therefore, I don't have to constantly change my brush size. You'll see me rarely like change my brush size more than once. I'll set my initial brush size, and then I'm just pressing down harder when I want it to be that big, or less when I want it to be smaller. So I'm not having to constantly go back and forth and say, oh, make it a little bigger, make it a little smaller, make it a little bigger, make it a little smaller. I make it as big as I'm going to need it, and then just don't press as hard when I need it to be smaller. So I'll put a link in the chat for the tablets here, and that link is just a standard one I give out when people ask me, hey, what tablet do you use? So it's just simply twhite.me/get-a-tablet. And it'll take you to some choices. Now, Wacom has choices that start at under $100. Like they've got their Intuos line, because they switched up the names. So Intuos now is their beginning line. Intuos Pro is their professional line. And of course, their super professional line is the Cintiq, which is a display with a tablet built in. So I typically, when I'm streaming, I'm using my Cintiq because I'm doing it from home. But you can also, of course, I certainly have traveled many years with just a regular Intuos Pro. And just, again, even if you have an iPad Pro with an Apple Pencil, you can use apps like AstroPad to turn your iPad Pro into a tablet. So there's several ways to do it at several costs or price points. And as I always say, even the cheapest tablet is better than the most expensive mouse. So what people are paying nowadays, you know, 60, 70, 80, 90 bucks for a good mouse, you could have bought a tablet for that same price and been that much better off. All right, so with that said, no problem, Victoria. I'm gonna switch cameras so you can, well, I'll switch cameras in a second so you can see the Cintiq, but let's go through what we're gonna do on these photos that I've got here so far. Now, in this particular case, I think I have done the initial work up front in Lightroom, but let me check. So I'll hit my D for develop, and that will take me into the develop module into Lightroom, and I can see all kinds of things I'm going to need to do to this photo. But what I like to check right off the bat is to see that I've done things like I've sharpened it already a little bit in Lightroom. I've gone ahead and adjusted my white and black points in Lightroom. I have not given it any vibrance, so we'll give it a little bit of vibrance. And I can see that I've got some blown out highlights there. So now on this histogram, you've got two warnings. You've got warnings for your shadows being filled in, and you've got warnings for your highlights being blown out. So basically what this means is when I hover over this warning and it shows me on the photo in red, spots in red, those spots in red have zero detail. In other words, those highlights are completely blown out. There's just nothing but white there. And you tend to want, unless it's the sun or a reflection in a bumper or something like that, you tend to want some detail. Like, you don't want it to be completely blown out. Now, the reason it's blown out, and I'm not so concerned on the background, is because I had two lights pointed at the background to make the white background completely white. Now, in this case, I can see the one on the left may have been a little too close. It might have been a little power, might have been up a little bit higher on it than it should have been. But the problem is, it's there, and how do I correct it? So whenever you have these warnings, which do you think is more accurate, the iPad Pro Pencil or the Surface Pro Pencil, Surface Book Pencil? The iPad Pro Apple Pencil is definitely more accurate. I've used both. And the Surface Book Pen, don't get me wrong, is certainly better than any mouse. But as far as the two put together side by side, I prefer the accuracy of the iPad or the Apple Pencil. But again, it's you asked me which one's better, and that one I think is better, but it's not that the Surface Book or the Microsoft Pen is bad. It's just the iPad Pro edges it out a little bit in terms of responsiveness and accuracy. Okay, so with that said, I've got the two. This histogram controls basically all of the same slider, or not all, but all of the tone sliders down here. So you've got blacks all the way here on the left. You've got shadows. You've got exposure here in the middle. You've got highlights, and you've got whites. So pretty much, you know, several of those tone sliders except for contrast. So if I head over here to the right side where the problem exists, I don't have to go down to the white slider and drag it. What I can do is just simply pull it back here in the histogram, pull it to the left. Now, you may get to the point to where, great, I pulled it over enough and it turned the warning off. That means I'm no longer blowing out highlights. Or I might have gotten all the way over to the left and it still would be a warning. And that just simply means you pull the whites down by 100%, or, you know, 100%, and that's as much as Lightroom's going to let you do. So in this case, I'm good with turning off that warning. So now when I head up to the highlight warning there, there's nothing being shown. There's nothing saying you're blowing out highlights. So there's detail in the entire photo in all the white areas. Let's see, what else? Okay, so we also can bump up the contrast a little bit. Now, sometimes I tend to want to do the whites and black warnings last, because some other adjustments might adjust them, you know, in the opposite direction. So, for example, if I bump up the contrast, that brought back the highlight warning. So that's what I'm saying. You tend to want to do all of the other things first, then worry about your highlight warning. So now that I've done the contrast, I can pull the highlights down a little bit more to turn that warning back off. So let's see here. If you're on a budget, MonoPrice has a line of affordable pen tablets that will do the job. Absolutely. Like I said, I don't care what brand. I like Wacom, but use whatever brand you can afford. Again, it's going to be better than any mouse that you use, or trackball, or trackpad. Hey, Nip45, what's going on? Or Nippy45, what's happening? Okay, so we've done that. I'm not going to do any clarity. I think I've already done my lens corrections. Yep, I've already done my lens corrections. I've already done everything else to this photo. So now it's time to head to Photoshop. One more thing. I forgot. There is one more thing I want to do. The white balance. Now I can see, and this is a typical problem, especially in the environment you're shooting in. Although she's standing on a white background, and I'm using daylight balance, strobes, and lights, and all that, the walls, as you can see above the backdrop, are beige. And therefore, light's going to hit that wall and bounce right back onto the subject or onto the scene and cast this beige light. So I can kind of see it. I don't see it in her up here. It's great. I can kind of see it in the background a little bit, where I'm getting a little bit of that extra warmth from the beige walls. Now, if you're okay with that, move on. If you're saying that's a little too warm and I wish it were not so warm because the, you know, lights are, the light or the walls cast the shadow, then you can adjust your white balance. So I tend to pick up the white balance slider. I may or may not like it. I tend to pick it up. And I would click on something that should be neutral gray, If I don't have anything, that's, she is not wearing any gray. I didn't give her a gray card to hold. In that case, then I would tend to use something that should be white or should be black. And the key words are there are should be. In other words, this isn't white right now, but it should be. So that's where I would click. And as you can see, it really cooled that area down. So this is your before. And here, let me redo it. That's your after. So it really took that beige tone out of the background and out of the entire photo that was being cast by the light. So white balance is another thing I'll go ahead and correct here in Lightroom, because it's, since I shot raw, it's all non-destructive anyway. Okay, so Papa Connus is asking, I'm wondering whether it's a good idea to use the Apple Pencil Surface Pen or to go for an Intuos Pro. It really depends on you. I would say if you are the kind of person doing this for a living day in and day out, then I would go for an Intuos Pro. If you're the kind of person that casually does this once, a couple times a week, then either the Apple Pencil or Surface Pen would be perfect. So it just depends on you. It depends on how much work you're going to do. In other words, you can't go wrong with either one of those scenarios. Either you're using Apple Pencil or Surface, or you're using the Intuos. You're already in the game, no matter which way you go. So it just really depends on personal preference at that point. At the end of the day, if I had to do this for 8 hours a day, I'd rather be on my Wacom tablet than my iPad Pro or my Surface Book. Simply because it's just a overall end of the day better experience. Now, if you said, hey, go off for a week on vacation and all you get to take is your MacBook and your iPad Pro or your Surface Book and your Microsoft Pen, I'm fine with that too, because that would be fine for a trip. It would be fine for something where I'm not doing it day in and day out. I'm just retouching shots that I'm taking while I'm on vacation. So it just depends on how long you're going to spend doing it. So that's it. All right. So now we got this adjusted the way we want. So I can pop back to the grid, or I can do it from develop, but I'm going to go ahead now and right click on this and say edit in Photoshop, or, from the keyboard, it would be Command E or Control E, on Windows. So now, since that is a raw file, a DNG, Lightroom did not prompt me with a, do you want to work with a copy or do you want to take the original over? Because when you're working with a raw file, you're not ever editing the original, so it doesn't have to ask you that question. When I save this and return back to Lightroom, it will be a copy. All right, so now I can go ahead and zoom up. And then the question becomes, okay, what do you want to fix first? Because there is no rhyme or reason, no rule that says you have to work on something first. But my inclination is to work on the things that are bothering me the most, because then that way I can concentrate on other things. If I start working on this little spot down here, but this is really what's bothering me up here, I'm going to work on that spot and I'm going to still be looking up here all the time, because this is what's really bothering me. So let's fix this stuff first and then we'll move on. Now, when I say fix this stuff first, I wouldn't have to worry about it if her hand wasn't interfering with the top of the roll. If like that top of the roll had been up higher, no problem. I can get rid of the whole thing in one fatal swoop. But because her hand is kind of integrated into it, I got to be a little more careful. I got to zoom in and see what's really going on up there and worry about not, of course, taking out her hand. So with that said, you can do this a variety of different ways. I could just simply... And I'm just showing this as an example. I could patch it out with a patch tool. So I could take that out and just patch it out. I could paint it out with the same color. I could clone stamp it out. I could maybe even heal it out. So let's use the healing brush here. I can go ahead and heal that out of there. It just really depends on what method you like best and what's going to work best for you. So healing, maybe not the best one in this case. So I think... to get around her fingers, the clone stamp tool is probably going to be the best choice. And then we can worry about, you know, globally doing the rest, which will be easier. But at least in this spot right up here, It's going to be easier to intricately get in and use the clone stamp tool to get rid of that gray. yes, I just crossed the line. All right, so let's get to the right camera first so you guys can see what I'm doing here. And let's get that stylus up that I was talking about. Did that work? Yeah, that worked. Okay. So now you should be able to see, now they may not be in sync. I have not tested this to see if this camera's in sync with what I'm doing on the actual big screen. But now you can see this is the Wacom Cintiq 27 QHD Touch. So this is their top of the line tablet slash display. And I'm using the Wacom pin that comes with it, which has at least 2048 levels of pressure, if not more, I can't remember, an eraser, and configurable buttons here to do whatever you want to do. All right, why not just make it a transparent background? Because I don't want it to be transparent. I want this to be white. And even if I wanted to make it a transparent background, I still have to get rid of all of this to make it transparent. So, and have the gray color on another layer. So, what this person's asking me, Opulaski, if I'm saying that correctly, that's an approach. Yes, I could absolutely get rid of the background, put a different background in, make it gray, do it. That's all subjective. This is the part I was talking about earlier. It's totally up to you for what you want to do. So when people come in and say, why not just, I would return it back to them and say, go ahead. If that's what you want for your photo, knock yourself out. But that's not what I want in this case. So I do want the white background in this case. All right, so we'll switch to the clone stamp tool. Now, in order to use the clone stamp tool, you can go in and hold down your Option or Alt key to pick a source that you want to clone from. And then once you pick that source, you're actually painting or cloning from that spot. Now, I just want to make sure my settings are good. Everything's 100%. All right. So now in this case, it's looking like it's picking up some gray. So that means I didn't pick a source that's, bright enough or white enough. Or you can also, of course, pick a source that's closer to the area you're trying to clone to get that particular color out of it. Now, the other thing you can, of course, do, and this is what I'm guilty of not doing very often, you can always make a new layer to do this on. So again, you feel better. You feel like it's easier to manipulate it that way. That's your technique. Do it. That's great that you feel it's easier to do it that way. Then by all means, do it that way. All right. Next, let's come over here. You know, it's like telling someone, "Hey, I prefer to drive." Oops, it's too far. I prefer to drive with my seat reclined at a 22-degree angle. I prefer to do it at a 33-degree angle. You're both right. It's what you prefer. So there's no right or wrong in that case. It's really up to the individual operator. Now, in this case, I am going to go smaller on the brush size. Sorry about that. I think I will put this back up here. All right, so this is one of the things that comes with this tablet. I liked it better with the older ones that were integrated right into the display. This is a separate remote. And on this separate remote, I can dial up or down things like brush size just by turning the dial. And they made it so you can, you don't have to have this on the display. You can lay it on your desk. It is magnetic, so it will adhere to the display or stay on the display. So you could use it like the old touch keys. I like the fact that you can have more than one. You can move it around. I had it laying on next to my keyboard earlier. So it is really up to you where you put it. But I still think I liked it better when they were integrated, just built in on both sides. That's just a personal thing there. Some people might love the fact that it's separate. So now I'm just patching to blend in what I did a little bit better. And same thing in here. There we go. And this is the kind of precision you can also get with a tablet that would be a lot harder to do with a mouse. Now, you may be a mouse ninja and you may say, hey, I'm very accurate and I do this all the time. Then by all means, do it all the time. Nothing's going to happen to your software. I'm not sure what that meant. Hello. May I see the photo shoot picture? All right. If you're talking about seeing the whole picture, I'm not sure what that means. That's the whole picture. But anyway, let's go ahead and zoom in and finish where we were. All right. So now that I've got it away from her hand, I can pretty much do whatever else I want to do at this point, because the hand is no longer interfering with the rest of the retouch. So for example, in this case, what I might do to get rid of that one extra line there is I might go in, actually, yeah, I could do it two ways. And I spend a lot of time just more time than I probably should just deciding which way I want to do something than the time it actually takes to do it. So for example, switching to the rectangle tool, but still going back to patch, I can still drag that straight down and patch that area like so. That was probably a little bit more than I needed. Let's try that on normal. All right, there we go. All right, so now we're at this point where we've got her hand is free and clear. We've still got, you know, this paper roll thing going on here. And the question becomes, obviously, we don't need the paper roll, so I could just crop down to this spot. Or if I want to save all the rest of this, how can I do that? Well, again, I could do that a couple of ways. Let me just get one more thing done here. All right, so now that I've kind of made it white all the way across, let's see. I can make a selection, expand it out. I could paint the top of it in. I can, you know, it's just like, which way do I want to do it? There's so many ways I could try this. All right, so let's try this one, for example. This is one that I do often. What you can do is once you have it consistently clear across the top, let me zoom down a little bit. I could go back to my rectangular marquee tool. I could make a rectangular selection of maybe even just this, just that, where it's no shadows or anything up there. I can now take that rectangular selection, Command J or Control J on Windows, that'll put it on its own layer. Now it's just a white rectangle on its own layer, and I can move it up and see what it looks like. If I like, it's not going to blend in, it's going to create a line because there was a shadow there, but I can now take that and free transform it. So I can say, you know what, pull that all the way across, and it's above her hand, so we're good. And then I can just go ahead and knock that down, all right, or lock it down. Now at this point, it, like I said, it would create a line because there was a shadow up there where the light was kind of blending off. I can keep it that way. I could, again, any way I want to do it. If I want to paint the whole thing, anyway. So I'm going to keep it that way for now, and I'll show you how to blend it in. I don't need that rectangle layer anymore, so I'll just go ahead and merge it down. That's Command E. And now, again, using the patch tool to just get rid of the line. Actually, rectangle is easier. Just get rid of that noticeable line here. I'm not going to worry about the sides right now. And I know for some, this is like, I would have done it this way, and this is more work. You're showing me more work. I'm just showing you a way. If you've got a faster, easier, better way, then you're ahead of the game. Go ahead and do it your way. All right. So let's, and I could also go the other way with it. Actually, that's cheating. It's going to take too much. So again, I can patch this in. And all I'm trying to do is build, I could have just easily cropped it, but I'm trying to build up this background and keep the image the same size. Once I've got the image the same size, that's bad. Once I've got the image the same size, then I can go ahead and blend the sides in and keep it all together that way. All right, so now I've got the top consistently the same color with no noticeable lines. And so now what about the sides, except that noticeable area there? Let's go ahead and blend that in. So now the sides. It becomes a lot easier once I take care of the top, because all I have to do for the sides now, same technique, but now I can go all the way down. We'll take the rectangle here. We'll start at the top, close to the edge. And we'll duplicate that onto its own layer, Command J, and just free transform it to the edge. All right, that takes care of that. Same thing on this side. Go back to the background layer, grab the rectangle tool, something right about there, Command J, and Command T to free transform it to the side. All right, so now we basically have filled that in all with consistent colors, consistent lighting, consistent everything. 20 ways to do the same thing, if not more than 20 ways. So it just really depends on you. Like the person said earlier, I could have just got rid of the background and started from scratch, created my own background. But what I'm trying to do in this case is I'm keeping the white background, because if I just take out the background and replace it with something solid, like a solid color, then what I won't have that I now have are the delicate shadows that are being cast, like down here from the skirt, down here from her legs, up here from her hands. Those are the kind of things that would get lost if I just simply took out the background. So remember I said I had a reason, or at least I said I wanted to keep it. This is the reason why I wanted to keep it. Because there's some subtleties in that background that I want to preserve. And again, you don't care about the background. Easy enough. It was a lot easier just to get rid of it. All right, so now that we've taken care of all the surrounding distractions, now it's time to zero in on the subject itself. I can see one. I'm okay with that. Okay. Yeah, and also removing the background would potentially look fake. But replacing the white background removes the texture. You see, so we could get into an argument and spend the rest of an hour talking about removing the background, keeping the background. We're moving on. All right, so let's move on here. And let's now get to the subject herself. Now, when you're retouching someone's face, you tend to want to keep them looking natural, keep them looking like their self. And when it comes to removing things like blemishes, acne, bruises, whatever it is, the rule that I tend to go by, and this is of course totally up to you and your client, but it's your call. The rule that I go by is if A, I wouldn't notice it in person, meaning I'm staring at a photo of her frozen in time. I never noticed those two little spots on her cheek before, or three little spots on her cheek before. I never knew they were there. If you would have asked me were they there, I would have told you no. That's one rule. So if I wouldn't notice it in person, then I'd probably go ahead and take it off. The other thing is to remove things that are temporary. Like I said, a pimple. We all have bad days where we wake up and something's out of place that won't be out of place, in 2 weeks. So if there's something that will be gone in 2 weeks, then it's usually subject to be gone in the retouch. Now, things I try not to get rid of are identifying marks. In other words, if she had a mole on her chin, that we know her because that's a beauty mark or a mole or something that identifies her, then in that case, I would leave it, because that's the subject's identity. Now, if the subject says, the model says, hey, can you get rid of that thing on my shoulder? I hate it. But it's an identifying mark, then it's fair game. You can get rid of it because they want it gone. And when in doubt, ask, hey, I noticed you got this thing on your neck. Do you want that there or not? And they will usually say very adamantly, yes, keep it, or very adamantly, they don't care, get rid of it. So it really, really, really is up to you and your subject and what the purpose of this is. So for example, she's got piercings in her ears, and she's got a few, look like more like acne than beauty marks here, that don't make up her identity. and are probably temporary. And I, like I said, I would have never noticed them in person. So I'm going to make the case to go ahead and get rid of it. Now, I am going to go ahead and duplicate the layer, something I don't normally do, but I'll do it so we can get to a before and after. And let me give you my layer thing. If you are the kind of person that needs to potentially go back and make changes, keep all the layers you need. That's what layers are for. Layers were designed since Photoshop 3 to give us the flexibility to try things, to come back and make more changes, to not ruin the entire photo because we made a mistake and we didn't see it right away. Those are all the reasons why layers exist. In my workflow, with the kind of work that I've been doing, I rarely get the opportunity to have to go back, meaning it's a production. So in other words, these shots are a shot, they're retouched, they're delivered, I move on. It's rare that I would have the opportunity to come back and say, you know what, on layer number 25, let me pull that slider back a little bit more. I just don't get the chance to do it. So that's why I don't, you personally don't work with as many layers. You keep all the layers you need. I'm not telling you not to. I'm just explaining why I don't. The other reason why I rarely duplicate the layer up front is because the layer up front duplicating, meaning keeping the background so that in case you make a bunch of mistakes, you can always go back and start over. My start over is the original RAW file. If I really need to start completely over, that's the RAW file. So I don't duplicate the layer for that reason, but in this case, I'm going to do it as a before and after. All right. Birthmarks that covered up by makeup. That might be the case. Yeah, it could be. Could be birthmarks covered up by makeup, but the point is it got covered up and not completely. So I'm going to go ahead and finish the job. All right. So I'm going to switch here. Yeah, I'm so used to having this on the other side. I'm going to switch to the spot healing brush. Now, this is another point of preference. I actually like the spot healing brush. I talk to a lot of retouchers that prefer the healing brush. The reason that I like it, because it's more of those, it does it right more than it gets it wrong. What I mean by that, with the spot healing brush tool, it's picking the surrounding pixels and filling in. With the healing brush, you're picking a spot like the clone stamp tool and telling it where to get it from. So professional retouchers like the healing brush approach because they get to decide what part of the skin or what part of the object it's picking up from. And therefore, they get it right all the time. For me, this is faster and it gets it right most of the time. And when it doesn't get it right, then I can try it again or try this tool. So the speed for me outweighs the benefits of the other one. But again, it's your choice. Use whatever you want. All right, so I'm going to go ahead and make my brush even a little smaller. And just go ahead and paint that in, that. And this is what I mean by, and instead of me having to pick a different source for each one of those, I'm done. Otherwise, I would have picked the source up here, did it, then came down here, picked another source, and did it, and it would have taken me twice as long. And it didn't get anything wrong. So that's what I mean by it's your choice. All right. Clone stamp works most of the time. 9 out of 10 times. Yeah, it's more like 9.5 out of 10 times. Really does it like totally miss the mark where I just, oh God, I can't use this. I got to do it a different way. Now here's my thing. This is a personal preference when it comes to the piercings. Now the piercings are fine. It's just, she didn't put one in this last hole right here. So to me, now that becomes a distraction because it's something missing. So in that case, I usually remove the extra hole. If the hole doesn't have anything in it, then it's gone. If the piercing's there, then of course we leave it because that's her jewelry, that's her identity. All right, so in that case, I'm gonna remove that hole because there's nothing in it and it's more of a distraction. All right, next, again, this stuff is up to you or your subject. I'm going to make the judgment call to get rid of it because it doesn't make up our identity and it's not something we would notice anyway. When you have little stray hairs on the clothing, it's noticeable. So you should probably go ahead and take it off. And that's why I like the spot healing brush, because I didn't have to pick a source for all of those things that it got right. All right. Now, one of the most, yes, my doorbell. One of the most overlooked areas of retouching. One of the things that people miss the most, for whatever reason, are hands. People skip hands. It's not that they do it on purpose. It's that they, I thought I got them all, but all right. No, those are creases. Oh, unless you're talking about that little thing there. All right. Anyway, I don't know why, but no, I didn't forget. I hadn't got to it yet. So calm down. If I say I'm done, then you can say what I forgot. All right. The reason that I think people just don't think about hands is they just don't think about it. But I've noticed like, perfect retouches, and the hand looks like something almost out of a horror show by contrast. Not that the hand is bad, it's just a completely unretouched hand with a completely retouched face. It's noticeable. So do whatever you're going to do, but make sure you just don't forget the hands. And what I tend to do on hands, of course, is remove any marks or sores or bruises or things like that, and she doesn't have any. If the fingernail polish was chipped or something like that, then I would go ahead and blend it all in, make it seamless. Her fingernail polish is fine. So that's not a problem. The only other thing that I would say that I tend to try, or not try and do, but tend to do, is that we all have natural lines from where our wrist folds and where our fingers fold and all that. And I look at it and say, does that, I know that's what we have, but does it add anything to the photo? And if it doesn't add anything to the photo, but becomes more of a distraction, then I'll reduce them. I don't get rid of them completely because then it looks unnatural if your hand doesn't have anywhere to bend. But like, for example, she's got a line going here, which is a natural fold, but then she's got one here where there is really no natural fold. That could have been caused by a sleeve. That could have been caused by a bracelet. That could have been caused by anything. So in that case, that's one where I'd probably go ahead and remove it. Because it's not adding anything to the photo. It's not part of our identity. It's not part of anything naturally occurring, or maybe it is, but it doesn't really add anything to the photo. Now, then we have the one where her hand really bends, but then we've got the one right under it. Do we need both? Probably not. So we're just basically cleaning that area up a little bit. And I would probably even switch over to the patch and blend that in a little bit more. So that's what I mean by just taking the time on hands to just look at them and make sure there's nothing really, you know, out of place or noticeably distracting. So again, this is what I mean by reducing the lines, not getting rid of them, but just, we don't really need to see that many. We know, so see, I want to keep that one because that is where the thumb bends. But we don't need all these. Okay. All right, same thing here. And this is also one of those things where it's like her hand's fine. There's nothing wrong there, nothing out of place. Just reducing some of the lines here. So little subtle changes, not giant changes, not something that is over the top. All right, so there is usually a case when someone's lifting their arm up, there could be a chance of razor stubble here on both sides. So let's come down and address that. Now, obviously, that is temporary. That is not something permanent. And we can address that a few different ways. One of the ways I could do it is with the clone stamp tool set to lighten mode. The other way I can do it, if I've got enough skin to work with, is I can work with the patch tool, which is faster. It just really depends on the amount and which way works best. So I'll start with the patch tool. And you could take it in different smaller areas first, or you can try and do it all at once, but I'll try a smaller area first. And just patch it up there, and it kind of smooths it out. But it may be making it too smooth, especially if you don't do it in the entire spot. Now, in a case like this, where there is a natural shadow, either you got to do it right on the edge of the shadow, all the way up, or include the shadow as part of the patch. Meaning not get rid of the shadow, but just drag the whole thing, shadow and all, to a different part of the shadow where it doesn't have the hair. And that cleaned up nicely. All right, so then we head over to the other side, which isn't as noticeable, but there are different skin colors here, different textures here. Now see, I didn't do anything to here, but that looks like it was patched already. That looks like it's smooth, so I don't mind continuing that pattern. Okay, now this is again another judgment call. We all have an elbow, but then sometimes you might have this other bone that sticks out. Does it add anything to the photo? It's naturally occurring, we all have it, but do we need to see it? And that becomes a judgment call in your case, but I wanna see what it would look like if I didn't have it. And see, to me, that just looks better. I don't know why. In other words, you don't look there and say, hey, there's a little bone missing. You look at it and say, she's got an elbow. You don't look to say, hey, there's another part that's not sticking out. So you'll, for example, on this side, it's barely noticeable, so I'll leave it. So you have to look at, especially on elbows, joints, knees, things like that, that are extra visible because of the photograph. Again, things you wouldn't notice. Like the one on this side, it's not in the shadow, so it doesn't stand out as much. So it's okay. It's there. It's supposed to be there, but it's not distracting in the photo itself. All right. I'm not going to touch that one. Nippy. All right. Let's see here. Let's go all the way down. Everything else looks good. Okay, now, before we go down to the leg, let me preface this by saying she's a professional dancer. A professional dancer falls every single day. I don't care how good they are. They're going to fall. So she's been dancing since she was a child. She's fallen for years. And therefore, there are going to be bruises. There are going to be marks. There are going to be things on her leg that aren't graceful. Let's put it that way. So what we're trying to do is not reconstruct her leg, but just remove the big noticeable bruises from the years of dancing. It's not a slam against her. It's just her profession. It's what happens. Like a football player, I'm sure it looks all bruised up after years and years of playing football. So if we look at her leg, I can see like all in here where there would be some opportunities to do things. Like for example, there's a bruise there, there's a line there, bruises, marks, bruise. And that's the rough life of ballet. It's just something that happens. But she's very good. She's expert. So we're gonna help her look more like herself. I didn't notice any of these in person, so therefore, they're going to go from the photo. All right. And I knew this even before I looked at her leg in the photo. I was like, oh, she's a dancer. She falls all the time. I bet her legs are going to be really, really scuffed up. And they are. All right, let's switch back over to the spot healing brush. Just like people forget hands all the time, they also tend to forget feet. So we at least need to go look. And on feet, you're going to have veins usually sticking out or popping out. And you have to ask yourself, yes, we all have veins, but do they really add anything to the photo? Seeing that big blue or green line in the feet or hands or arms. And if not, then probably you should make it less noticeable. All right. Same thing here, this line, do we really need it? Probably not. Looks pretty good the way it is. Okay, see where we are. So see, I zoomed out, it still looks like something there. So sometimes when something's noticeable zoomed out, I try and repair it zoomed out and it just does a bad job. So I need to zoom in. Just trying to blend all this in so it looks the same. And it does. Now again, this is more noticeable because of the lighting casting the shadow off the knee, because the light's coming in from up above, making this lower area darker, making the whole knee more noticeable. So depending on how that ultimately looks, I may make a change to it. Light can make a subject look better or much worse than they really are, depending on how the light, that was bad. Depending on how the light is, what the light is focused on. Okay, so just show you where we came from. That's our before and after. Oh, how did this get moved? Okay, hang on, this got moved somehow. All right, anyway, that's our before and after. So again, not a giant change, just a lot of little subtleties. If you look at the legs before, look at the legs after, not a giant change. Under the arms, the elbow, not a giant change. Now if we zoom in, before, after, I haven't touched the hair yet, but just some subtle changes. Yes, you have to you have to step back and look at the whole thing in most cases to really see what you've done, because zoomed in is a totally different look in a lot of cases than zoomed out. All right, so now she's got some stray hair, as most people with hair would have. So the question becomes, is it okay to, I didn't mean to zoom in that much. Is it okay to have the hair? I would probably say some of it yes, some of it no. Like, for example, I don't like this one hanging down on the other side of her chin because it looks like it's hanging from the chin. So that would definitely be a candidate to go. Some of this hair coming off the back here is probably going to go. And then what I don't like is where there's a little poof of hair sticking up and nothing in between. And it's curved back down, because that definitely looks like a mistake. So some of that will go. Some of this off the back will go. Then there's some stray hairs or hairs out of place inside or on our head. So we need to see what we're going to do about that. So now let's do a little bit more with, or do something with the hair. And again, this could be, Nathaniel's tip was using the regular healing brush with the replace mode on a new layer. This could also be done with the clone stamp tool. It could be done with the patch tool. It could be done with the healing, regular spot healing brush. It could be done a lot of different ways. So in this case, what I could try, just to see what happens, is that. And that did a nice job. Now, the reason that did a nice job is because it was pretty much isolated. It was easy enough for the algorithm to pick up all the white area around it. And even though I see something right there, that's easy enough. Easy enough to take care of. All right, zoom out. Yeah, you'd never notice it zoomed out anyway, but even zoomed in, you don't see that anymore. Okay, so that hair is gone. Now back here, I wouldn't use the spot healing brush because it's going to take too much work. In other words, I can start doing some of it, then it's going to start picking up some of the other hairs, and it's just going to blend in too much. So the spot healing brush on a big patch of hair like this, not a great way to do it. Is this a repeat from the other day? No, it's more of the same. So I'm not repeating anything. These are all different images. Or is that an earring cause is not white as the rest of earrings? Are you talking about this up here? It looks like a piercing. Yep, that's earring. That's not skin. All right, so spot healing brush, bad tool for this. So that either is going to lead me to the clone stamp, because the patch also is going to just require me still to work on the edges. So I might as well just do it all either with clone stamp or with the... I know it looks like a mole. I thought it was a mole at first too, but then it was too perfectly shaped and on the earlobe. So that's why I figured it was earring, and it is. But yeah, it's just darker in color. Don't know why, but it's not a mole. And even if it is a mole, that's probably a mole. That's one of those identifying marks I'd keep. So all of the above. All right, so in this case, I could try one of two methods. I'll try both and let you decide. So let's go to the clone stamp tool. And once I go to the clone stamp tool, again, we're going to zoom in a little bit more so we see what we're doing here. And I see there are little fine hairs all the way out to here. Now, the problem with the clone stamp tool is that this is one of those where if the background's all consistent, then it's easy. If the background is varying in degrees of white, like it is from here, going from white up to gray because there's less light up here behind her head, then in that case, you might want to try the other method we're going to try, which was the one Nathaniel introduced me to. So let's go ahead, or introduced us to. So let's try the clone stamp first, I'd have to keep sampling all the way up, or at least keep it aligned all the way up so the lighting would stay the same. So we're going to come out here, hold down our Option or Alt key to pick a spot. Let's go actually all the way out here. Now that I've done that, I keep it aligned, meaning coming all the way over here. And that way, as I work my way up the photo, the lighting stays the same because as it goes darker up here, so does the source. So that's just another technique or another trick if you're working with a graduated light source like I am here, to keep the lighting consistent instead of sampling way down there where it's nice, bright, and white, and then trying to clone way up top where it's darker gray. Now I have to be careful because if I come out too far, I'm going to grab part of her arm. So I'll get that in another pass. And then speaking of another pass, if I make a mistake now, I'd have to do it all over again. So it's a lot easier sometimes to start, do a little, stop, let go, do a little more, because then if you need to undo, you didn't undo everything you just did. All right. So now let's see, I can probably come in here a little bit and get some more of that. I let go. Now in this case, I'm going to get a little closer because I need to. And if you keep it aligned with your background, meaning the lighting's going darker as we go up, then as long as my source is staying aligned with what I'm trying to do, I won't notice any difference as I go up and down. Wow, you're dating yourself if you're saying VHS cassettes. There's some people here probably don't even know what those are. But I knew what you meant. All right, so that looks good. Same thing. keeping it aligned and getting rid of that little poof. We've spent a lot of time on this photo, way more time than I would have because I'm explaining as I go. All right, but anyways, now we're coming to the other side, so we need to pick a different source. We need to come on the other side and do the same thing. Keep it aligned. And that way, as we work our way around or up, the background stays consistent. Holding down my space bar to move it up and down. All right. So now I'm going to switch back to the spot healing brush for these hairs that are going against the grain, so to speak. Going against, I'm seeing the cloned area as noticeably lighter on my screen. Just an observation, not a critique. I'll zoom out and see it. I'll zoom out and check it, but I don't see it here. But if you're seeing it, then I'll show you what I would do anyway, whether I can see it or not. All right. Here, let me zoom out. Let me check it. You may be right. Yeah, see, I'm not seeing it, but I'll show you what I'm going to do anyway, just to make sure. In the case where I can't really see it, but it might be there, I'll show you what I'll do in just a second. Let me go ahead and take care of these hairs. So the spot healing brush on Content Aware. And a lot of times too, when you're doing those clones, it may appear lighter, at least for a second, because that's just your eyes playing tricks on you. I'm not saying that's your case, but maybe you're playing tricks on me that I don't see it. But what I tend to do with a clone is blend it in when I'm finished with the patch tool. So that even if there were something I didn't notice, like I'm not noticing now, that would go ahead and take care of it. What version of Photoshop did I learn with? You started with version 2.1. I started with the same version, I guess it was 2.0. But I started with 2.0 right before 3.0 came out. So I wasn't on 2 that long. That was bad. I think I was on 2 for maybe a few months, and then 3 came out with layers. And so, by the way, you know, like I said, I take layers for granted now because we've had them for so many years. Imagine a time where there were none. Like, there was no layers. You had to do everything on the background. There were no multiple undos. If you messed up 3 steps later, you had to just start over. There was no way to go back. There was no way to, you know, undo or step backwards in history. There was no history. There was no editable type. If you typed on a layer and hit OK, it would become pixels as part of the layer. So it was resolution dependent as well. So like I said, we take a lot for granted today with the power of our computers and our versions of Photoshop. Yeah, so retouching, you had to be perfect back then because you weren't allowed to make very many mistakes. Unless you just had a lot of time on your hands, you need to start over and over and over again. So I still don't see any difference in shading, but just in case, what I tend to do is everywhere that I've done the clone stamp is just to make sure it blends in. I'd grab the patch tool, make sure the patch tool is on normal, and just take that area that I just cloned. Maybe something like that. Oh, sorry, that was a bad one. Hold on. Something like that, and just patch it over. So that way I'm blending in any brush strokes that I don't see where there might be a visible difference. I'm not seeing it anymore. So same thing up here. We come out, make sure we get all of this. And of course you could zoom in and go closer. And just patch it over. And that should blend in any noticeable differences. I'm not seeing any. But just in case you're seeing them on Twitch, that should have taken care of at least most of them. All right. All right. So now, got rid of a lot of the distractions. So here's what we're going to do here. So I could make her eye a little lighter. I'm not going to, but I could. Instead, I'm going to switch to my sharpen tool. Take the brush size way down and sharpen that eye, which will make it stand out a little bit more anyway. Sharpen the jewelry. And she's not wearing any earring or any rings or anything, so I don't have to worry about that. But I would sharpen the things that like should be sharp, like shiny objects, her eyes. If she had glossy lips, I'd sharpen those a little bit. Any rings she'd wear, any necklaces, I'd sharpen those. If the shoes had any kind of stones on them, I'd sharpen those as well. I still may sharpen like some of the edges around the shoes. Just not pressing down as hard, getting some of those straps. All right, and so again, our before, not noticeable zoomed out, but zoomed in. Our before. And our after. So look at her eye. I didn't brighten her eye, I just sharpened it. But look how much brighter it gets just with the sharpening. Just to make the eye stand out just a little bit more, not too much, just a little bit more. Okay. Next thing I'm gonna do is go in and do a little sculpting or dodging and burning. And for that, I've got an action set up. I've got my action set to button mode. People always send me a message later and say, hey, there is a bruise on her upper thigh, the one in the front. Let's see, is that a bruise or a shadow? It might be a shadow. That's a shadow. Or maybe, I don't know. Well, now I can't tell. So since it's distracting you, I think it's a shadow. I think this is mostly shadow, but just in case. Yeah, that's definitely shadow. That might be a bruise. All right. Yeah, see, the problem with the knee is that I could just continue going. I could spend all day on the knees and making them perfect, but she's a dancer, so I don't want them to be too perfect. All right. The thing that people always ask me all the time is, hey, how did you make your, is this a plug-in? How did you make this happen? So all you have to do is just in your actions panel, switch to button mode. So that's built in. That's not something I added. And then what I've done is I've created an action called dodge and burn. All dodge and burn does is duplicate the background or duplicate whatever layer you're on or the background. And it sets that blending mode to luminosity. So the difference is Nathaniel on Tuesday was using two different layers, one that he would use with the blending mode set to darken, one he used for lighten, and then he was brushing on those gray layers to dodge and burn. Again, that worked fine for him. Everyone has a technique. I actually prefer the dodge and burn tool because it's just gotten so much better over the years with the protect tones feature. So that switched me to the burn tool. I'm going to zoom in a little bit. And what I'm looking for, I'm going to take my brush size down a little bit. Since she's smaller person on this canvas than a portrait. And I'm going to go in and so there are areas that are naturally dark from the shadows, like around the edges of her arm. And they're in her legs. And then there are areas that are naturally lighter where the light's hitting it. So all I'm doing is accentuating those areas. So I'm just going to go around the edge and just lightly darken that a little bit more. Areas I want to kind of stand out or have a little bit more contrast, I should say. So I'm just brushing ever so slightly. And again, this is what you don't get to do with a mouse or a trackball or a trackpad, is because once you click, it's full 100% whatever that tool is set to. Here I'm just lightly brushing this in. And see, down here is just pretty much all shadow. So maybe I'll just do the back of the leg. And I don't really care about under the arms. Don't really care about anywhere else. I do care along the hairline. All right, so now we switch to the opposite tool, which is the Dodge tool. And change the brush size for that. I'm going to make that smaller. And now I'm going to just accentuate the highlight, the natural highlight occurring from the light itself. Like that, just about there. So that's coming right down this arm. Right down that arm. And maybe brighten the eye a little bit, coming around the contours of her face. And definitely down this one leg, because that's where the light's hitting. Now, it doesn't look like you did a whole lot when you do this, but let me show you the before and after. That's before, that's after. Just that little bit of contouring, that little bit of dodging and burning, is one of the finishing moves I do that kind of just makes it really pop, makes it stand out just that much more. All right. I can't believe there's a conversation about floppy disks going on in the chat right now. Wow. Okay. For those of you watching this on something else like YouTube. Or the video on demand, I should say, on YouTube. Yeah, I'm pretty much happy with that. Okay, so again, if we were to zoom in and we were to look at our before, that's our before, and that's our after. Before, after. So if you're the kind of person that says, hey, I might want to go back and work on any of these, then keep all your layers. A lot of people would have more layers than I do. Keep them all. I would merge them down personally because I'm not going to come back to them, but I'm going to keep them just for you guys. Just so you don't freak out. I'm just checking the eye, making sure there's really nothing going on up here. Yeah, there's a little going on up there. Let's do this. Oh, that's the one I want to be on. I want to be on that one. And let's just get a little bit. All right. There's a laugh line there. I'll reduce it. The problem is I need to reduce it on both. There are lots of little hairs I can clean up on the ears. But again, I could spend another hour on this, or I could spend no more time on this and be happy with it. All right. That's our ballerina. Completely rebuilding the background from scratch. Or the edges of the background, I should say. Retouching the skin. Dodging and burning. Getting rid of stray hairs. So forth and so on. This makes you want to edit a photo of someone with the flipper. Okay, I'm not sure what that means. Saving. And once we're saved, we'll go ahead and close it. And move on to the next one if we got time for another one. Next one's going to go quicker. I'm not going to explain as much because you kind of get the idea. Ah, you usually use Photoshop for art. Okay, I get it now. All right. So now we can also compare it with the original. So here's the original. That's what we started with, just out of the camera. So we had that problem with the background, not going all the way above her hand. We had the sides, which are easier to fix. And then we had all the issues that we had on her. And then we ended up with that. So that's the after. So the before. Look at the legs, look at the arms, look at the tone, look at the dodging and burning, and the after. All right. Okay, so now in this collection, I don't need the original anymore. Still the original, still in the folder. I just don't need it in this collection because the collection, when I'm done, should just be all the finished retouches. Now, let's see. In the time we have left, I think I want to do this one. This one doesn't require any background work. I think I've already done all the work that I'm going to do here in... Oh, yeah, there's a background issue, but that's an easy one to fix. Add a little bit of vibrance. And a little bit of contrast. And fix our highlight. And see where the back... Or the... I'm not worried about that one. Okay. So now let's go ahead and edit in Photoshop. And the biggest problem on this particular image is because of the odd backwards stance that she's in. All of this, all of these wrinkles. And I almost didn't want to tackle this one because of all of these wrinkles. Obviously this isn't the way she looks, but because of the weird angle and she's trying to focus her attention, she caused all these wrinkles to appear on the top of her head. But let's go ahead and get rid of some of the obvious stuff first. So we're just going to go ahead and select. Oh, here we'll duplicate the background first. All right, there we go. And then we'll go ahead and just make a selection. And from there up, Command J, Control J on Windows, Command T, Control T on Windows, free transform. And we'll just fix that edge. All right. Merge that down because I just don't need it separate anymore. And now we'll go ahead and, again, the thing that's bothering me the most is the stuff that's going on up here. So there's lots going on here, lots of things that are just caused by the shadows of the lights. Because now you got to remember, she's upside down. So the light's coming down on her, casting all this shadow under her eyes. That wouldn't naturally be there, but that's being caused from her cheek getting hit with the light and then casting a shadow here. So this is a shadow I don't mind removing because that's not real. That's not the way she really looks in person. And then we got the forehead to deal with, which that in and of itself is going to be a challenge. All right, so let's go ahead and take, and then she's got marks here from the top on her left shoulder. And these look like just freckles, or I'll probably reduce some of that. But let's go, and the eyes stand a little sharpening. So all kinds of things going on here. So let's first of all deal with, trying to deal with some of the shadowing here. So this again is all, we saw her before, she didn't have any of this. So we know she does not have big dark marks under her eyes. So let's kind of clean that up a little bit. Now I'm going to leave a line under there that's naturally occurring. That is part of her eye. But the dark shadows are kind of unfair. Because if she was just, had I brought the light down a little bit more, she wouldn't have had those dark shadows. Or had I focused it right on her eye a little bit more, she would have been fine. So that's my fault, not hers. So just blending this all in a little bit better. All right, there we go. That looks better. That is bugging me. No. All right, that I'm going to have to zoom in for more and take a little better look at it. Same thing here. These shadows are being caused by her chin and her lips and everything here, but it's not as bad. I'll deal with that in a second. So now let's deal with this. What are we going to do here? Well, the first thing we need to do, clean up the area below so that we at least have something to work from. This is all forehead that is caused by the hanging upside down. Look, so she does not have three big wrinkles on her forehead naturally. Harry, would you flip this image to see upside down? This is hurting my neck. All right, no, I won't flip it, but because then it will even look weirder to me. So I'm sorry, I can't flip it. Do not try this at home. She is a professional. And she did not once complain that the blood was rushing to her head, but I didn't keep her in this pose very long. All right, that's just making a mess. Well, let me clean it up the other way. Okay. So now, what's causing this to look like this? Are the actual lines, and more than the lines is really the shadows of her face being cast like this. Now I'll clean this up some more, but I just wanted to get a foundation that was a little cleaner than what I had. And now I can attack it wrinkle by wrinkle. So one of the ways to do this, which I haven't shown before, I haven't shown on this yet, I'm going to switch to my clone stamp tool. I'm going to set my blending mode to lighten and set the opacity to about 40%. There about. All right. So now I can take this area that's lighter than this stuff up here. So option and click. And then I can just lighten that area up. Because now by this clone stamp being on lighten, it won't affect any pixels that aren't already darker than my source. So like if I came all the way up, it's just gonna lighten up that area. And it's using the same skin texture at 40%. Why 40% instead of 100? Just so you can do it more gradually and not apply too much at once. Because see, once I do it again, that would have been 100%. That's too much. So I'm just going to come up here. All right. And that spot right there is probably bad. Okay. So now I've got it a little bit lighter. It's a little bit easier to work with because now we just need to get the slightly darker lines to blend in like so. And don't worry, I'm going to blend this all in when I'm done. I'm just trying to get it more consistent than it was. So I use the blending mode lighten anytime I'm trying to remove a dark spot. Ooh, that's just not pretty. And I use the blending mode darken anytime I'm trying to remove a hot spot. In other words, a spot that's too bright. And I'm kind of patching this all to kind of get it at least more consistent in color and consistent in light as we've come a long way already. That's why I love the patch tool. On normal, because it blends in more. If I use it on content aware, it tends to make it too exact. And there are times where I need it to be exact, but this isn't one of those times. All right, so this is where we came from. We came from that to this. From that to this. So you're probably thinking, wow, it still needs a lot of work. But look at how far we just came in that short amount of time. And also, you got to remember, too, I'm zoomed in at a level that no one else is going to see because this isn't a headshot. When we zoom out, that's the way it really looks. So it's those little things that still aren't perfect. No one's ever going to see them because this is all they're ever going to see. So now we just don't see all those big lines going across her head. Now, it doesn't mean be lazy and don't finish it, but it just means that you don't have to be as critical to all the little blotches here and there because just nobody will see them. Now, what I can continue to go back and do is now that I've got that kind of cleaned up, I can go back to my my clone stamp tool set to lighten. Pick a nice spot that's kind of even. Hang on, it's just not giving me what I want right there. Hold down my Option or Alt key. So if I start here and then come out here, that's just going to brighten all that up and make it consistent. Same thing, go over here. So that'll get rid of a lot of that unevenness. Right off the bat. And you want to try not to go over too many areas you've already been over because then it's just going to make it lighter. And I don't want it to be too light. Or just don't press down as hard. See, that's too light. Too light. Undo. That's going to be about right. So then I can just grab a little bit more. A little bit there. A little bit there. And then we went again from that to that. Okay. Yes, I can continue working on it, but we're going to move on for now. Kind of blend some of that in. Get rid of that shoulder strap mark. Now that little hair kind of floating there kind of bothering me a little bit. So that's a perfect use for the spot healing brush. There we go. Same thing there. And again, some of this I'm going to leave. I'm not going to get rid of all of it, but we don't need as much of it because we wouldn't notice as much of this in person. I didn't know she had any of this standing there. So just reduce it. Freckles are cool. Little hairs on her costume are not. Okay. I see, this is what I meant by hands. So she's got veins, she's got a little bone popping up there that we all have, but is it adding anything to the photo? We can't get rid of all of it, but can we reduce it? Can we make it less noticeable, less distracting? And I think we can. And sometimes I'm afraid to get rid of this, but then I look at it and say, is anyone going to say, hey, what happened to the bone that was popping up in her hand that should be there? And no one ever asked that question. So again, veins are natural, but we don't need as many. No sores, no bruises, no bumps on the hands. So we're good there. And just making it all less noticeable. See, a lot fewer veins than we had a minute ago. Head over to the other side. Same thing here. We got some lines, some marks. That's all good. But then do we need all of this? I don't think we need all of it. That one, probably not. Do we need that one? Probably not. All right. That one can probably go too. And the rest looks good. All right. Am I going to keep the darkness above her lips? I don't know yet. Probably going to lighten it. All right. Don't forget the legs. We're focused so much on up there. She's got legs too. And this is what I mean by the veins are, they're naturally occurring, but do they add any benefit or value to the photo? And I would probably say they're probably more of a distraction. All right, so now we'll switch back to the... By the way, this is often the thing that happens where I have a little selection that I forgot about or I can't even see. Then I go to do something with another tool and it won't do anything. It's because you can't do anything while you've got something else selected. You can't work on a different area. So even if I didn't see it, which I didn't that last time, I just hit Command D, which is deselect. So if you have something selected somewhere by accident, you don't even know where it is, you don't have to worry about clicking on a different tool and clicking off of it. Just hit Command D on Mac, Control D on Windows, and that will always deselect whatever it is that's selected that you don't care about being selected anymore. Sometimes I'll go to run a filter and it only runs on that one little spot, because that one little spot was selected. And it's like cancel, Command D, run the filter again. I'll say I got about 20 minutes left in my stream. What camera did I use? I used my Nikon D810. Who's up next, moderators? I forgot to change my up next banner. Now, the bottom of the shoes, what do we do there? Do we keep them kind of rough? Or do you clean them up at least a little bit? I think the roughness adds some kind of part of the story. In other words, she's been doing this a while. But how rough do we need them? Again, up to you. Jason's on next, Beetlejace. All right, you know what? We're gonna make that happen. Here's how I change my lower thirds, by the way. We're gonna take a quick second, pop over to my lower third. We're going to change that from up next, Beetlejace. Save it. Now this is using Photoshop's ability to generate image assets. So that one little piece just got set up as a ping. I'll close this now. And that's syncing over to my streaming computer. And from that computer, I will do my up next. All right, See how quick and easy that was when you're using the power of the Creative Cloud. All right, back to our face here. So someone said, am I going to get rid of the shadows there? That isn't bothering me. Yes, it's bothering me, and yes, I will probably do it, but that's not bothering me as much as this shadow. That one little eye. This is still just, I'm just not getting what I want here. Probably because I'm using a method that isn't as good. All right. There we go. Just paint that back in. Now, what I did there was I just bailed on what I had done so far. I hit the letter Y to go to my history brush, and then I could just paint back in time what used to be there so I could start over again and do a better job. So that's what I just did there. So now I can do a more consistent. There should be a shadow along her nose, but I don't know that I want it that big. Let's see what that does. Yeah, that's better. I was just trying to do it in smaller chunks. It wasn't working out. Okay, so now let's talk about these shadows. Do I need these? Probably not. And again, it's all naturally occurring stuff that we just see accentuated because of the lighting, because of the way she's hanging upside down there. Okay. That one I'll keep. That I'll keep. This I'll get rid of. That I'll get rid of. Now, to the eyes, they could be a lot sharper. Let's go ahead and grab a sharpen tool. And we're just going to go ahead and sharpen those eyes up a little bit because they look almost out of focus. And if we zoom out a little bit, before, I moved it again. Hang on, how did I move that down? Let's zoom all the way out. There we go. Before, Jesus, I thought I moved this back up there. Hang on. Zoom all the way out. Okay, now. All right, zoom in. Before, after. And when we zoom in more, look at the eyes, before, after. Just a little bit of sharpening. Yes, I do sharpen the lips when they are glossy. Her lips are, they could probably look stand a little bit. They're a little bit more subdued. She's not wearing lip gloss, per se, or at least not a lot of it. So I'll sharpen just a little bit of it. But yes, I do. And I'll also sharpen earrings. And rings and necklaces and jewelry. All right. So again, our before and after zoomed all the way out, which is where people will see it. Now, the thing that's kind of bothering me zoomed out, these look like little indentations on her right shoulder here. So something's going on here. It's just a shadow, but it's got to go. Let's keep that a little bit more consistent. All right, let's zoom out again. And see, now I don't like it in this spot. That's better. Don't mind the muscles, don't mind the arms. That's all good, that's all good. Okay, so now we go to our dodge and burn. So my dodge and burn action, which just duplicates that layer, sets it to luminosity mode. And it automatically switches me to the burn tool. I always burn first, then I dodge. I didn't do any of the flyaway hairs because we saw that technique last time. But I would go around one last time and look at the hairs to make sure that there's nothing too bad sticking out. All right, then we switch to the dodge tool. Make that a little bit bigger. Pressing ever so lightly around the edges there, right down the middle. And before, after. Before dodging and burning, after. All right. And that's our finished photo. Big difference. A lot of little differences that turn into, oh, see, there was some stray hair that's got to go. All right, let's get rid of this. Some of this has got to go. Be sure to follow me on my YouTube channel as well as my Instagram for my pick of the day. Next week on Tuesday when I'm back, I'm going to... I might do it on social media beforehand, but I'm going to do a portfolio review, kind of a blind critique of images. So if you want to submit images to the blind critique, I'll share a way to do that either on social media before Tuesday, or I'll probably just wait till Tuesday, share how to do it, and then we'll do it on Friday. We'll actually do the critique. I participated in one, a couple of them actually, on Kelby One's The Grid show, and they're kind of fun. Well, fun for the critiquer, not necessarily fun for the person submitting their work. But it's blind, so in other words, no one gets embarrassed personally. They don't get called out. We don't show the name of the person or anything like that. We just talk about what's great about the photo and what could be improved. Before, after, just to show you where we came from. Thank you, Olus Design, appreciate it. Still seeing little veins. Now, what I... judgment call. Because of the way her shoe is laced up tight around her ankle there, it's kind of pushing that skin out, making that bigger than it really is. And same thing here. So I might go into Liquify and just touch that up a little bit. Hey, Echo Seth, how's it going? Got to dodge and burn it. All right. So we got a few minutes. All right. So filter. Now, by the way, if you convert the filter for smart layers first or smart filters first, that will create a smart object out of that layer. At least it should. Did I actually do it? Okay, maybe I didn't do it. And once that layer is a smart object layer, then it will which I probably should have done on the layer below. But that will then make this filter for liquify non-destructive. All right, so when I go to liquify and I want to zoom in, and I want to go down there, and I want to go to my warp, which is the letter W, and I want to make my brush smaller. Maybe something like that. Just want to push that in just a little bit. And push that back in just a little bit. And push that in just a hair. There we go. Because that's really just being caused by the straps. All right, so now we click OK. And that becomes, because we did it as a smart filter, it becomes non-destructive. So as long as you keep that layer, you can always turn it off, turn it on, or get right back to the original. And because I didn't do it on the layer below, you can get right back to the original effect. All right, so if I turn that off, that's going to screw up the whole thing. So let's see, can I copy that if I do this? I've never tried that before. Let's try this. Convert for smart filters. The reason we're seeing it sticking out because I did it on the wrong layer, or did it on the, I should have done it on the other layer. I'm going to try something now. What did I just do? There we go. So I converted the second one, the one I should have done it on, to a smart filter or smart filter layer. And then I held down my option key to drag that effect down to that one, so I wouldn't have to do it over again from scratch. The other way would have been to just simply go up to the filter menu and run it again. If you run it from here, that will do the exact same one you did last time versus doing it from here and starting over again. So I could have done it either way. Alrighty. I think that's going to be it for now. So we've only got 6 minutes left. Let's go ahead and save this. Whammo! Oh, well, I'm glad you could sit and watch me do this for days. I do this sometimes for a day where I have a lot of retouching to do, but I appreciate you hanging out and saying that. Retouching is one of those things that people are always usually, I'm fascinated by when I, because there's always little bitty things you can learn, little things, little tips, little tricks, maybe even a different way of doing what you already do. So retouching is one of those things that always stops me in my tracks and say, ooh, what are they doing? How are they doing it? Did they figure out a better way to do this thing than the way I'm doing it? So forth and so on. When is Stephen Burns going to be here? Didn't I hear next week originally? StarCrunch can probably answer that question. This is always why I don't like that many layers. The more layers you have, the bigger the file, the longer it takes to save. You learn to pay better attention to hands. It's a dead giveaway because people spend all the time on the face, the body even, and they never retouch the hands, and the hands are a dead giveaway in the retouch because they look completely out of the camera and everything else looks perfect. And it's like, whoa, what happened to her hands or his hands? You want to retouch someone that's 50 years old? I actually have a video. I named it retouching for a mature audience. And that's what it is. Retouching someone who's older and things to look for and things not to do because they're old, they're a certain age. So therefore you don't want to make them look 20 years old. So, you tend to retouch more than your client needs. Yeah, I used to really overdo it. So I've scaled way back than when I first started. Because when you first started, you're excited. You do everything that can possibly be done. And you end up making the person look much, much different than they really look. Or probably really wanted to look. So it's very easy to overdo. That's why, like I said, this is, you know, I could certainly keep going on this. I could make it over the top, but I try not to because that's not the goal. Now, if I'm doing fantasy Photoshop and I'm trying to composite this and just make some crazy design, then yeah, that might be over the top. But as far as delivering a finished image to a client, they probably don't want to not look like themselves. And when we go over the top, that's what tends to happen. All right, so here's our original. That's where we started. And here's our finished one. So again, nothing over the top, not too much, just subtle changes to make this image look better. Especially the biggest thing that was bothering me about this photo was all the wrinkles from hanging upside down on her forehead that she doesn't naturally have. So that was the first thing that had to go. And again, had I not done anything to the hands, look at the hands, look at the way they used to look. Had I just done everything else, the hands would have even looked more out of place. Now that left hand could probably stand to use a little bit more, but it's okay in conjunction with the rest of the photo. So hands are important. As well are feet. If the feet are showing, if they're wearing shoes where they're open-toed or anything like that, you got to make sure you do the feet as well. But, there we go, before, after. Okay, up in 1 minute and 13 seconds will be our one and only Beetlejace, Jason Levine, who I'm sure will be doing something audio and or video related. All right, so here's one we didn't get to. This is the one that I would have done next. The first thing that would bother me was this strap sticking out. So, you know what? Let's pop over to Photoshop in like 1 minute, if I can get it open in time. And I'll show you a technique just to get rid of that one little thing. See if it opens quick enough. It's opening. And it's a patch tool technique, but it's one of those, it's along an edge, so it's going to be harder to do. So if you grab your patch tool, and you grab even the thing you don't need to patch, and you drag along that thing you don't need to, this is gonna not go well because it's dipping down a little bit. But this is what you tend to do along an edge. You wanna drag it along the edge so that when it patches it, it's not, it kind of takes that into account. So I would need to keep going down in order to get that. But that's one of the techniques for patching something along an edge like that to make it blend in more naturally. And I just need to fix it down here as well. So same thing, something like that. And I would just need to keep working my way up and get that edge all the way around. But you get the idea. So whenever you're patching, that's the way to do it. Continue working though, I'm not finished. So thanks for watching. We'll catch you next week on Tuesday, same time, same channel. Up next is Beetlejace making an album, recording, overdubbing, and mixing Beetlejace art. Jason, take it away.